I hope that's on. Those of you who are not here last week or you didn't remember to bring your sheet that we're going to be working on this morning, I have a few here that are left over from last week, so I ran a few more copies. So if you'd hold up your hand, I'll hand you a copy. This is Discovering the Promises for Commitment, Hebrews 13, 5 through 8. Anybody else? Can't have a program. If you don't have a program, you don't know what's going on. Yeah, that's right. Okay, good. In the series that we're looking at, we have spent a great deal of time going through a passage of Scripture, going clear back to Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in verse 18, and now we're coming to the end of the passage that we're looking at Hebrews chapter 13, 5 through 8. Okay, so that's essentially where we are. Let your character be free from the love of money, being content with what you have. For he himself has said, I will never desert you or leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. So that we confidently say, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What shall man do to me? Remember those who led you, who spoke the word of God to you, and considering the result of their conduct, imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today, yes, and forever. We first looked at the idea of your character being free from the love of money, and we've taken a good close look at that, and I gave you several different passages in the Bible that basically talked about the love of money, and what we found is within those passages, the word content was also linked with this problem, and so that was something that I never knew. So when I was studying this, it seemed as the major passages that had to do with the love of money and infiltrating your character had to do with the issue of you being content with what God has given to you, not just in physical things, but the circumstance and the way that circumstance is working its way out. Okay. And that's essentially what we find the word contentment having to do. It's not so much the idea that you're content with the material possessions that you might have, though that's part of it, okay? But you're content with what God has put you in, okay? And the places that he has allowed you to be a part of. And right now I'm reading a book that's probably the best book I've ever read, okay, on suffering. And suffering has to deal with the issue of contentment. Okay, what you find is as I studied this phrase and the promises that are associated with the word contentment, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you, do not be afraid of life and what men can do to you. Okay, I am the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Those are the promises that are to cause us to be content. Okay, and opposite that is the love of money. And what that really means is that you look for something else to stabilize your life. Okay, you look for something else to keep you from being forsaken. Okay, you look for something else to keep you protected. You look for something else that gives you that stability today, yesterday, and tomorrow besides God. And in your mind, you go, well, I always use God. Well, yes and no, you don't. Okay. And so that's kind of what we've been looking at in terms of this particular passage. And the book that I have just mentioned to you that has to do with suffering and how contentment is to be found in the middle of suffering, okay, is by Tim Keller. Walking with God Through Pain and Suffering is the name of the book. Okay, and Ron Jared gave it to me, and he said it was the best he's ever read, so that's why he wanted me to read it. And I'm not through it. It's so deep. It's very, very strong, very, very it covers an enormous amount of bases. And so it's very, very good.
What's the name of the book?
Again, it's by Timothy Keller, and the name of the book is Walking with God Through Pain and Suffering. Okay. We are at a point in our study of looking at these promises that God has given to us to be able to for us to be content in our circumstance. Okay, what is it that causes you and I to be able to look at where we are in our life, and even though that life is disturbed and struggling and we're afraid of the future or what is presently right in front of us, okay, how is a man to get to a position of being at peace with this, being content with this, okay, and not always wanting something different? Okay, and so how is it that you're supposed to get to that point? And one of the ways that you actually get to the point and walk through it, and this, in my opinion, this is not just getting to a kind of state, okay, it's actually being able to move through suffering, move through the areas of your life that would cause you discontent, okay, that would cause you struggle, right? Well, what is it that gets you to a point to where you can live with this? Okay, and according to what we find, God says it's me, my person, and what I have promised you. Okay, that is how you get through this. Okay, it's my person, and what I have promised you, and those promises link to my person. Okay, are the things that cause you to have an anchor to your soul. Okay, there are things that you can lean on. They're steadfast and they're true. And there are things that cause you, during the midst of this struggle that's causing you to be discontent, to move you to contentment, but also move you into a deeper state with God, move you into the veil, behind the veil. And that's what we studied in Hebrews chapter 6 associated with this passage. Okay. So these are promises, three of them. And what I've found in studying them is just a deeper sense of what this means and facing these kinds of situations. In other words, these promises and these things that God has given to us to walk through times that are struggles and hard, okay, these promises and his person attached to them are the very things that hold you, okay, and allow you to actually move through the valley of the shadow of death. Okay, and so that's essentially what you are finding in these. We looked at the sheet last week, and we were just beginning on that sheet, and we were looking at the first promise. And the first promise is that I will not desert you, or I will not leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. And this is to bring about a contentment inside you. Okay, no matter what happens out there, and when you feel as though you're alone, you feel as though this is more than I can handle, you feel as though the circumstances are bigger than what you are. A sense of loneliness, even though you have a mate that's with you, okay, there is still this sense of loneliness, okay, and a sense that I don't know what to do. And in my opinion, there's a great fear in this. Okay, there's a disquieting within your soul, and that's why you're not content. In other words, you're not at peace to be able to handle that particular situation. Well, how do you get something to help you? You have a promise from the person of God himself saying, you are not alone here. You are not alone. Others may desert you. Even you yourself might desert you. Okay, but you are not alone. And the other major promise there is you are not forsaken. You're not forsaken. Okay? And that is the whole. That is to bring you peace. That is to bring you contentment. And I have found myself saying that phrase over and over and over again as I have been disquieted within a day. You really honestly do feel alone. Okay? And there's just no doubt about it. You just have this sense inside of aloneness. Even though you're in love with a mate and the mate's still there. Okay? You're inside your body, inside your mind, with inside your personality. And there's nobody in there but you. Okay? Except God. Okay. And then there are many, many, many times that you feel as though he's not there. Okay, because there are several psalms that even talk about that. Psalm 88 and Psalm 39. Okay, these are two psalms in the Bible where they end negatively. And actually the last in Psalm 88 is, I am alone and I am in the dark. Okay, and that's how it ends. Okay, but the point of it is, even though you do not feel that, the promise is that that isn't the truth and that is wrong. Okay, the truth is, I will never, ever leave you, nor will I ever, ever forsake you. Okay, and that is what we hold on to give us a contentment within the midst of the deep sense that we're not content at all. Okay, it brings us to that contentment. Okay, all right, so we looked at the word leave last week. It's a fairly simple word. It just basically means you're not in the building, you know. You're not there, okay. It's like God has disappeared. He's walked out the door and moved around the corner and down the street and the next state. Okay? He's not here. Okay? And he says, that will not happen. Okay? Now, the word forsake is a lot deeper. Okay? It's a lot harder. In relationship to what it means. It does have the idea of somebody leaving you. Okay, and let's take a look at the definition. I leave, but it's stronger in its idea. To give up something held dear. Okay, forsake means something that you have loved, something that you're close to, but you give it up. And give it up means you let loose of it and you turn your back on it and walk away. Okay? So it has a far more emotional meaning in the word itself. Okay? To renounce, applied to a man giving up all that he believes. Okay? This is an apostate. So you can use the word forsaken. This is all that I believe and I give it all up. I forsake it. So it's a very strong word. It's everything that I am and everything that I believe, I give you up. Everything that God believes about you, everything that he has connected to you, everything that he has given to you, he forsakes it. He gives it up. Okay. So that's how strong that word means. Okay. Even his love for you, he gives it up. He forsakes it. Okay. He doesn't believe in you anymore. Okay, and so that's kind of the idea of the word. It's a very, very strong word. Okay, when it says it's when it's applied to God, those who are his believers, he is always there, not departed. He holds us close to his heart. He is one with us. We are held dear. He will not loose us from his presence of enfolding. How can he? He is one with us. He will be with us forever. He abides in us and will always enfold us in his everlasting arms of love. He will continue to disclose himself to us. We are glorified in him. We will never, ever be forsaken because Jesus became the forsaken one for us. The condition of forsaken no longer exists for us. Now, there are two ideas here, okay, in this explanation of this idea. Number one is the main reason, okay, that you cannot be left and you cannot be forsaken is because God is one with you. Okay? He's entered into your spirit and your life, and he has mixed himself with you to where you cannot become anything but one. Okay? That's the main reason that he can't forsake you. When you became his child, his promise was, I have entered you, and I will never, ever break that apart. That is why we have assurance of salvation. He will not leave. His statement is, I will not leave. I am one with you. So I can't forsake you. You are one with me, and I am one with you. And there is no way that that can be dissolved. Okay? So that's an enormous statement in terms of what's going on. We're going to read these two passages that state this. Okay? So there is no way he can forsake us because we have become one with him. The other one is that essentially the concept of forsaken has been all brought upon Jesus. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Every theologian tells you this is at the point that Jesus did not want to go. Okay, when you talk about the Garden of Gethsemane and it's asking, is there not another way? Okay, and God says, there is no other way. And Jesus accepts that and then goes to the cross. And when he says, my God, why hast thou forsaken? He entered into what he did not want to enter into. God turned his back and left. He forsook him and everything that he was. And we have no concept of what that really meant. In other words, we've tried to delve into it before in this class and other theologians, but that is the point where the transfer of everybody's sin in this room and everybody's sin that's a part of the universe, okay, was put upon him, and God forsook him because he became sin. And at that particular point, we became righteous. We knew no more sin. And that transfer is the forsaken. And when that transfer occurred, God turned his back on his son. Okay, and he forsook him. Okay, that's when that occurred. And because he forsook him, we are never forsaken. Ever, 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 ever again. All the forsaken was placed upon him. All the loneliness, all the darkness, all the evil, everything was placed upon him. There is not a word called forsaken in our vocabulary. That's the promise. Because what he did, and he became the forsaken, you and I are never, ever left. That condition is no longer a part of us. Okay? That's what he did. Okay? And so that is the depths of the love. That is the depths of its meaning. And when you and I begin to feel and move into the state of that he is forsaking us, that is absolutely wrong idea. It's an affront to God when we move into a position to where we say, He has left me. He has forsaken me. Now, we sure feel it, and God allows us to feel it. Okay? He allows us to issue forth. The whole Psalmster, all the book of Psalms shows the pain of humanity, okay, in its loneliness. But at the same time, God is telling you straight out, you do not need to be in this position. I have promised you, and you need to get back to a state of content, because I will not leave you. You may have felt it, but it's not there. It's not true. I put all of that on my son. And that condition is no longer for you. You are not forsaken. Okay? So that's what you find. Now, when I started looking at the different men that God gave this promise to, as we're going to study here, Jacob, okay, then we're going to look at Joshua, then we're going to look at Hezekiah, okay? When I started looking at them, every single one of these men were in a position of extreme sense of being forsaken and alone. And God steps in and says, you're not. Even when you feel like you are, you're not. Because I am God. And that has been removed from you. Okay? So that's what you see in relationship to what he's saying here. The other one is that one of the reasons, okay, is that God has, because of the forsaken, okay, and it's no longer ours, is because he is actually now literally entered into the soul of every one of us. And we have been bound together. And because of that, the condition is he is bound to us, and he will always be bound to us because of the forsaken of Jesus. Okay. So this is the truth. This is the reality because of the forsaken. Okay. And where is that truth? John 14. So if you would turn to John 14. What you should be able to do through these lessons and what we've been doing, but it's really just the Word of God giving this all to you, is to put these together when you have this sense of being forsaken. Okay. And bringing you back to contentment. So if you go to John 14, this is an actual familiar passage, but if you actually put it in terms of what we've been talking about, it becomes alive, beautiful, and huge. Okay? So, John 14, verse 15. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. The process has not been finished yet. He has not been forsaken yet. And our sins are still on us at this point. He has not gone to the cross. He's in a day of going to the cross. And he's saying, one of the biggest things that's happening is that I will come to you. I will come to you. And you will become one with me, and we will be one forever. I will be your helper. I will be your comforter. And that could not happen until I was forsaken. But once that happens, this happens. And it's forever. That's what he says. Jesus said to them, verse 17, that is the Spirit of truth. That is who's going to become one with us, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not behold him or know him, but you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Now, I don't know about you. I've read this many, many times. But when you attach it to the idea of you're not content, when you attach it to the idea that he will not forsake you, okay, when he says to you, I will come to you, okay, I will abide with you, I will not leave you, I will not let you be an orphan. Okay. These are tender, beautiful, meaningful statements that tell you that you are not forsaken. Okay. They're the content of it, and they're the reality of it. Okay, in terms of what condition really are you? You are one with him because he was forsaken. You no longer have any concern about being forsaken. Okay, in any circumstance that you have in your life. Okay, so that's what you're saying. A little while the world will behold me no more, but you will behold me. Because I live, you shall also live. And in that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. That's the final statement. Then he goes on to say in verse 21, I will love him, the very last words. My Father will love him, I will love him, and I will disclose myself to him. So this becomes the content of what the reality is when you and I face circumstances, suffering, discontent, fear of the future. Okay, we don't know what's going to happen. All these things would cause us discontent, or we would reach for something else to give us security. Okay, and God says to you, okay, the only thing that you reach for is me, and I'm already there. Okay, and I will never forsake you. I will never give you up. I will always love you. I am one with you. You are my son. I will take care of you. I will minister to you. I will help you. I will comfort you. And I will deliver you. Do not be afraid. Okay. And so those are the things that he's basically stating. Okay. So it's a very beautiful passage. And of course, the high priestly prayer in John 17, 10, and then 22 through 26 says the same thing over and over again. I don't have this down on your sheet of paper, but I'm going to read you another one that's out of Isaiah chapter 43. Again, one that you and I are very familiar with. But all of these words are the words that you use as promises to help you find that contentment again. Isaiah chapter 43, 1 through 3, and then verse 5. But now says, thus says the Lord your Creator, he who formed you, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Since you are precious in my sight, and then verse 5, do not fear, for I am with you. Okay. So those are the descriptions that you get in other passages that help us see this truth. Okay. All right, well, let's take a look at Jacob. We have about 15 minutes here. We can probably get through that. And then next week we'll look at Joshua. Very beautiful passage in Joshua. So Genesis chapter 28. This is the first time that the actual word leave, associated with the presence of God, that he's not going to leave you, is actually mentioned in the Bible. Okay, and it has to do with Jacob. It's Genesis chapter 28, verses 10 through 22. Now, what is Jacob's situation? Okay. Well, Jacob has just deceived his father and received the inheritance, okay, the blessing from his father. Okay. His father did not want to give it to him. He tricked his father into giving it to him. He wanted to give it to Esau. So Isaac wanted to give it to Esau, and Jacob tricked him and got the blessing himself. Okay. So there was a great deception here of his dad, and he received something that he actually was going to Jacob. It looks like he was going to lose. How was he going to lose it? His brother was going to kill him. The one way Esau could actually get back the inheritance would to kill his brother, if you had ever thought of that. Okay, of course, Esau was enormously angered at all this, okay, and he lost it all. His father said, Esau, isn't there anything for me? And his father said, no, I gave it all to him. Okay. And Jacob, of course, has to flee from the presence of his brother. And he has to flee for years, like 20 years. Okay. And even when he comes back, he's absolutely terrified that Esau is going to kill him, that he has not changed his mind at all. Okay, so the fear is a 20-year fear. It starts right now that his brother is going to kill him. And he takes off, and he's going out of the country because his mom said, you're going to have to leave. And so he's taking out, he is totally, absolutely alone. And he's heading towards his uncle's house, which is a long, long ways away. And the first night, when he sleeps, he lays his head down on a stone and dreams. And he has Jacob's dream. Okay? And what is said in this passage has to do with his condition. And his condition is he's not a man who follows God, and yet the promises of God are being connected to him. Okay? God has a plan for his life that Jacob doesn't even understand or doesn't even really conceive. Okay? He's also absolutely alone. His mom's not there. His dad is against him. His brother's against him. He's lost the protection of his family. He's going to an uncle who he has no idea about. And his uncle is not a good guy. Okay. And so he's lost, he's gained everything by deception, and he's lost it all. He's one blow away from losing everything. Okay. He's not married, has no kids, he has no money, he has absolutely nothing. And he's troubled. I would say he would be troubled, you know, and definitely afraid of the future. Okay, so these are his conditions. Almost every single person that has this promise dropped on them and the presence of God about not being left or forsaken is in this condition. They are in very strong circumstances that make them very, very discontent. Okay, they are definitely struggling with life and what life is. Okay, so he lays his head down, and what you find is that God speaks to him through this dream. And he came to a certain place that night, verse 11, chapter 28, and he lay down on a stone, and he had a dream. And behold, a ladder was set on earth, and its top reaching to the heaven. Behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it, and behold, the Lord stood above it, and said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the land on which you lie, I will give it to you and your descendants. And then verse 15, and behold, I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Now that is just another statement within the statements that God wants us to hold on to. I have a plan, and you shouldn't be discontent with my plan. I will not leave you until I have completed all the promises that I have made for you and to you. I will complete them. I will not leave you. Those promises will be complete. Now, when we looked at Hebrews chapter 6, it says, you and I are heirs to all the promises that God has given to humanity. Even though they're particular for different groups, like the Jews have some particular ideas, within those ideas are blessings to you that are promises. Okay. And so essentially, God is saying all the promises, when we read John chapter 14, those were promises. I am going to be forsaken, and I'm being forsaken to you. I will come to you. I will unite with you. I will help you, comfort you. Okay. I will not leave you as an orphan. I will be one with you. I will love you. I will disclose myself to you. And every single promise I have given, I will complete in your life. And I will not forsake you or leave you until that is done. Now that's a whale of a statement for us to hold on to when we are hit by life. Okay? It is something that is very beautiful. The ladder goes up, and it says, at the top he stands. The sovereignty of God is at the top of the ladder. He stands above it. And he comes and sends down the angels to tell you these promises. I mean, the only thing that was being, this ladder was bringing nothing but this particular statement. I will be with you until these promises are done. And then later on, we find out they're forever. Okay. In other words, Jesus is saying, I will come to you, and these promises are forever. Okay? And you hold on to them as the core of our relationship. Because I love you, and I will disclose this to you. Okay? Now, Jesus said the same thing in John chapter 1 when he saw Nathanael. Okay? And Jesus quotes Jacob's dream. And he says, to Nathanael. Nathanael said, you know, you saw me in the garden praying. He said, you are the Son of God. And Jesus said, you mean you, that's what convinced you that I'm the Son of God? He says, you will see heavens open and the angels of God descending and ascending upon the man, Son of Man. It's the same figure. Okay, and what he's basically stating is, I will always move to you to minister to your life. I will never forsake you. I will never leave you. I will bring those promises to fruition. And Jesus is stating, I'm the one who will cause that to happen. Okay, and so this is what's behind that promise. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. Thus you can be content with what I bring into your life, okay, and allowed to be there. And you're to find the contentment through this promise. Okay. I will love you. I will comfort you. I will help you. I will walk with you. I will disclose myself with you. I will not leave you as an orphan. I will move this to a good conclusion. Okay? Even though what it looks like is not a good conclusion. You're to believe in my promise and hold to that. Okay? Now, in this book by Timothy Keller, at every single chapter, he ends it with a person writing a story. Okay? He's a pastor of a huge church in New York City, right in the middle of Sin City. Okay? And every philosophy that's against God at its peak. Okay? And he's winning more and more people to Christ in that city than anybody else. He's got all sorts of churches that have spun off of him. He's an enormous intellect. Okay? But what he has to say is really wonderfully put together. And he has a person write a story of their life in terms of a circumstance. And if you read these stories, you realize that you haven't gone through much. Okay? When I read them, I go, I don't see how anybody could live through that. Okay? And almost every single one of them, horrific. And these people were walking with God like the death of a child. Okay, a crib death. Okay? And how this mom and dad responded to that crib death. Okay? And how did they respond? They responded because of this. I will not forsake you, and I will not leave you. And the promises I give to you have an end of good. And I will complete it. I am the sovereign above the ladder. And I am control of every single event. And I am connected with you. And I will bring this back to you. Okay? And so that's what you find. I am with you. I will keep you. I will bring you back. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Okay? Then what you find is that Jacob responds to this. And we haven't spent much time developing our response. Okay? This is the promise. And then God asks us to respond. And what we're going to do is look at Joshua's response, what God tells Joshua he has to do. And Jacob has his response, and then Hezekiah's response. Okay, and so what you're seeing is God stepping in and giving you the promise. I'm just giving you the promise. He's giving you the promise. Now everybody in this room has to respond, okay, as they deal with the circumstance of their life. Okay, and Jacob is the least of the responders, because he came into the circumstance without really knowing God at all. Okay? And even towards the end, he had not implemented what we would consider godly things. For instance, his whole family was idol worshipers. And God told him at the very end, in chapter 35, okay, after he had already gone through all the experiences that he had had with God, and he had already come back and Esau hadn't killed him, and he was in the land, okay, and his family was utterly worshiping idols, and God steps in and he says, I brought you back here, now get rid of the idols. Okay, I kept my promise to you. I have been with you all the way, and everything I promised you, it has happened. Okay, you named the place where we met Bethel and changed it from another word which meant almond tree. You named it Bethel, and that is the house or the gate to God, the gateway to the house of God. And he tells him to come back to that place and throw away all the idols and dedicate his family and himself again. And that's exactly what he does. He clears out all the idols. He goes back to Bethel and dedicates his life again to God. Okay, as to what and how they would serve. And so that's what you find him doing. Okay, as he responds to what God asked him to do. Okay. So it's a very beautiful passage. It's the first time that we have that particular idea linked to the promise, I will not leave you and I will not forsake you, okay, in the Bible. Okay, next week we'll look at Joshua. It's actually a far more beautiful response by Joshua and a lot more said by God about how you handle these circumstances, okay, and the promise, I will not leave you or forsake you. Okay? All right. We'll see you next week.